The Cannabis Conversation. A European perspective on the emerging legal cannabis industry.
Welcome to the Cannabis Conversation with Anuj Desai, where we explore the new legal cannabis industry by speaking to the professionals that are helping to shape it. Got a really interesting show for you this week on the difficulties of trying to fit cannabis into the Western medical system. There's actually so much to talk about that we actually ended up making it a two-parter. But first, I wanted to say a big thanks to Bloom Jobs, who've given me a nice push on social media this week. I'm all about encouraging people into the industry and growing it, and they're the premier recruitment company in the European space, so I'm really happy to be associated with them. If you're a business in this sector and you're looking to recruit, you should speak to these guys. If you want to get a job in this sector, you should speak to these guys. They cover the whole category from plant touching, jobs like cultivators, to medical, clinical staff, to business ancillary roles like sales and marketing. They also hire across the board from CEO down and are active in the UK and Europe. So if you're interested, please check them out at www.bloomjobs.com. That's BLUMEJOBS.com. And check my LinkedIn too, and I'll put some links there. Okay, now on with the show. On today's show, I've got Gregor Zorn, who is a medical cannabis educator. He's also co-founder of the European Cannabinoid Therapy Association, as well as performing a number of different roles in the cannabis industry. I'm really excited about this show because today we're going to talk about the difficulties that cannabis faces in terms of fitting into how Western medicine operates. Welcome, Gregor.
Hello, it's a pleasure to be here.
Glad to have you on board. Thank you. Cool. So look, there's loads to talk about, but why don't we just kick off as usual with a bit about you and your backstory and how you came to study cannabis and what you're up to at the moment.
Yeah, sure. So I studied biology at the university, Biotechnical University in Ljubljana. And after finishing it, I actually specialized in nutrition. And I was always interested in holistic approaches to health. So natural remedies and all that comes along. And my, let's say, path into cannabis was, well, it was quite a few years ago that I attended actually a symposium that was in Ljubljana, where there were a lot of doctors, international doctors, coming from all over the world talking about cannabis, cannabinoids, and how we can use them to treat different medical conditions. And this conference was really eye-opening for me. It was really interesting. I found that it could have a great potential. So having a biological background, I started researching this subject and reading all the studies and so on. And I never stopped, actually. I'm still doing it. So it's a fascinating field, and it's an evolving field, and we're learning so much new information about this plant and its therapeutic potential every single day that it's really, really a great area to be in. Since then, of course, I try to learn as much as possible. And it's really interesting when you see how much work has already been done in the past. This plant actually has been used for thousands of years for therapeutic purposes, and not only therapeutic purposes, for just about everything. It has been used, you know, as hemp. You can call it hemp or you can call it cannabis. Actually, it's one plant. It is cannabis. And it really is, I would say, the most useful plant crop that we know today. But as I mentioned, I was especially interested in the therapeutic uses, and I tried to attend as much of these conferences and symposiums and courses as possible, learning everything about cannabis and learning from the top specialists in the world about cannabis. And then when I had enough knowledge, I also started teaching this subject, because you well know this is something that is not known by many medical professionals. But the reality is that a lot of patients are using it. So there was a need for these patients to have guidance. So I did do consulting. I did guide patients, despite the fact that it's not my job, you know, but they needed it. So I was obliged to do it in a sense to help these people, making these protocols, just teaching them about how to start the dosing, the different types of cannabinoids, their effects, and so on. A good practice for me, you know, receiving all these feedbacks from all the patients that were using it, which is incredibly important, the feedback that you can get from patients that are using it, because you know what's actually helping them. and they can give you really good information on what is helping them for their specific symptoms for their specific disease. As you mentioned, I then also co-founded ECTA, the European Cannabinoid Therapy Association, and now I am mainly focused on medical cannabis education, doing all sorts of events, courses, trainings, and symposiums, and so on for different groups, for medical professionals like doctors, nurses, pharmacists, and so on, for students, and also for patients, and just about anybody who's willing to listen and is interested in this subject.
And there's lots of people who are interested. I mean, I've had a few people from science backgrounds on the show, and I always love just how excited they are by this subject because of how much there is to discover. And it sounds like that was very key for you as well.
Absolutely. I'm very interested in, you know, in understanding the mechanisms of how it works.
Yeah. I mean, we can come on to this in a minute, actually, because there's obviously lots and lots to talk about. If we can sort of start from the top, and if we're talking about the Western medical model, it might be useful if you just maybe give us the basics on how Western medicine operates in relation to how we treat people and what types of medicines we prescribe to people.
Well, anybody who has been to a doctor or has been in a hospital knows a little bit about the Western model of health, where it's basically, it relies heavily, of course, on the use of these synthetic pharmaceutical drugs and, of course, surgery, different kinds of operations. So cutting and taking out things that don't work, in a sense. And also, of course, different types of other medical procedures, such as radiotherapy, such as stays in the hospital, and so on. So this is the basis of this modern type of model, which we are all accustomed to, so which basically is just focused mainly on treating the symptoms of a disease. And we can see this from just about the majority of the drugs, pharmaceutical drugs that are present on the market, and you can find in the pharmacies, they're all targeted into fixing the problem. And the problem is usually a symptom. So you have a pain, an ache, you have a headache, and so on, and you just want to get rid of it. It's a quick fix, of course, you know. And you're
An example, sorry to interrupt, just for my own understanding, an example would be if you have some pain, you'll get prescribed something to help you deal with that pain rather than what's causing the pain.
Exactly. You will get prescribed something to take care of that symptom. Let's say in the case of a headache, I have a headache and I go to the doctor and say, okay, I have a headache. I cannot work, concentrate. I have to do something. And he will give me a medication that will take care of the headache. I won't feel the pain anymore. But did I take care of the reason, of the cause of this headache? Because a headache can be for many different causes. It can be something wrong in the head. It can be something wrong around the body, in different parts of the body. It can be a totally different thing. And a headache, the pain, is actually just a symptom. But so are we treating the cause? Are we treating the symptom? That's the main difference. And if you don't treat or try to find the cause of this pain, then this headache will come back, usually, if we don't correct what is not working correctly in our body. So this is the main difference when looking at our body and treating a symptom or a specific, let's say, part of the body, an organ, a tissue, and so on. So this is the approach when you have problems, let's say, with your liver, you treat your liver. Or you have problems with your head, you treat your head. But the thing is that we are not separated. Our body is not separate in a sense as in medical books, where all these organs, all these symptoms are separated. We are a integrated system that works, a complicated system that works very efficiently most of the time. And it's extremely complex, and it's a, let's say, a whole system that is not separate between all these parts. We have a, like to say it, we are like a small ecosystem. You know? All these parts work together to provide us with functionability, so we can function, we can talk, we can sleep, we can work, and so on. And it's incredibly complicated if you look at the small parts, how all these small parts, if you go down to the cells, which, you know, make the organs, which make the tissues, it's incredibly complex how all these components work together to make a perfect entity so we can walk, watch TV, and so on. But sometimes when these components don't work, we can have problems. And for different reasons, it can be environmental, it can be genetic, it can be an injury and so on. Things cannot work correctly. And then we have to do something about it. And this is the main, let's say, difference between the approach that we see now in the modern Western world, where we're treating a specific area, a specific symptom, instead of treating the whole body, or treating the body in the sense to find out where is the cause of this illness, of this disease, where is the stem, where is the root. And this is something that has to be taken care of if we want to have, let's say, a good outcome of the treatment. Because if you're treating the symptoms, you're not taking care of the cause of the symptoms, and you will be having these symptoms on and on and on, and they won't stop. Of course, there's another factor of using these synthetic pharmaceutical drugs, which are the adverse events or the side effects. If these drugs didn't have all these side effects, and if they worked perfectly, we wouldn't have this discussion. But they do have side effects, and they do not work. A lot of times they don't work as they should work. And that is why people, of course, are trying different things, are trying other things, natural remedies most of the time, to find a solution to their problems. And and this is where cannabis comes in.
Yeah. I mean, that's a really good rundown. Thank you for that. I think, you know, the side effects thing, I remember I saw someone talking about epilepsy who was using cannabis, and they said that previously they were on a cocktail of, I don't know, 10, 15 pharmaceutical drugs, of which probably four were sort of treating the epilepsy and the rest were to alleviate the side effects, which I found quite amazing.
And this is not amazing. This is something typical, you know?
It's quite typical, yeah. I mean, and actually I look at my father who has high blood pressure, and the cocktail of drugs he has to take every morning is a similar sort of regime where half of them are combating side effects.
Exactly. And all these synthetic drugs have different types of side effects, which can be short-term or even long-term. And these effects, of course, sometimes they're not so intense, but sometimes they can be really, really hard on the person or the person's health, and they can provoke other problems and other symptoms. And it just goes on and on. And then you have to take more pills and so on. So it's really not a very efficacious way of treating symptoms of a disease, because there are side effects. And of course, many times often we see how it depends on how the drugs work, that they can also have a reduced efficacy over time. So if something helps you at the beginning when starting taking, let's say, a synthetic drug, over time, the efficacy of the effects of these drugs, it goes down.
So is that like a tolerance? Do you build up a tolerance?
Yes, sometimes it is tolerance. Sometimes it is just changes. Sometimes it doesn't work anymore. But in the case of tolerance, we can see this in the case of opioids for the treatment, let's say, of pain. So opioids, oftentimes when you start taking them, they can have a very good effect. They can relieve the pain. And over time, you have to increase the doses of these opioids to achieve the same effects. And this is due to the mechanism of how opioids work in our body. So it's just a mechanism that you develop tolerance. So you'd have to have higher doses to have the same effect, let's say analgesic effect, anti-pain effect. And this, of course, then causes, because these opioids can also have other side effects. In the case of opioids, it's very interesting that these opioid receptors, which opioids actually bind to, are present in some areas of the brain where you have these centers for breathing and heart control. So this is one of the reasons why opioids are dangerous in a sense, if we're taking it long-term, and can have so-called overdoses. The thing is that if you have to increase these amounts to have the same effect, you can increase them to a level that these opioids can actually be in your body present in such a high quantity that they can bind to these receptors present in the brainstem and other areas of the brain where we have these specific centers for, say, for breathing, and they can actually stop breathing, because it actually has this function of desensitizing the breathing mechanism. And this is how many times you will see people overdose, because they stop breathing. What's interesting with cannabis and with cannabinoids is that the same areas where you have these centers for breathing actually have very little to no cannabinoid receptors. So the receptors, the places where these cannabinoids can bind to, they can deliver this message, they're actually not present in this area. And this is one of the reasons why we never have had a documented case of somebody dying because of too much cannabis, in this case of too much THC, the psychotropic ingredient tetrahydrocannabinol, because it cannot produce this effect that can be produced by other drugs such as opioids to actually have an impact on these breathing, on the breathing functions of your body. So to stop breathing, it can actually not happen with THC. And this is one of the reasons why THC and other cannabinoids have such a safe profile as drugs, let's say, as compounds.
Yeah, I mean, let's go on to talk about that then, because okay. I think you've done a good rundown on the standard pharma drugs that we have. They are usually single compound or maybe a low number.
Compounds usually.
One or two compounds. Yeah. And they often have side effects. You often can build up tolerance to them, or they lose their effectiveness over time. Now, let's go on to talk about cannabis. How does cannabis differ from this sort of conventional medicine?
Well, we have to start, of course, as I mentioned before, with the active compounds that are present in cannabis. Cannabis sativa, which is the Latin name for cannabis, or hemp. Hemp is just defined as cannabis with a certain percentage of THC allowed. And different countries it's different. In our country, it's 0.2%. That's the limit. In other countries, 0.3. Then we have 0.6 in Italy and up to 1% in quite a few countries right now. We started with Switzerland, and now we are seeing places in Australia, and also Ecuador, I think, just did this change to allow 1%, and Uruguay, I think. These are the four countries that I'm aware of. So it's hemp. It's a man-made definition. Plant is one. It's one species. It's cannabis sativa. And then you have different varieties. And of course, different types of hemp have been bred for different, for specific reasons, for having a lot of seeds to make oil, for having long stems to make fibers, and so on. So with cannabinoids and cannabis for therapeutic use, the main goal is to have as much of these active compounds in different ratios in the plant. The plant produces these compounds called cannabinoids, and to distinguish them between other types of cannabinoids, the ones that are synthesized in laboratories, we call them, those are synthetic cannabinoids, and the ones that we produce in our body, which are endogenous cannabinoids, so to shorten down, we call them endocannabinoids. We call the plant cannabinoids phytocannabinoids. So these are produced by the plant. They're produced in special structures in the plant called trichomes. And it's interesting to note that these trichomes, which are like little droplets on a stalk, they actually store the cannabinoids and other constituents such as the terpenes and terpenoids on the surface of the plant. So this is important to note. So many plants produce active ingredients inside the leaves or the stems or, let's say, the flowers. But the cannabis plant actually produces these compounds, the cannabinoids, the plant cannabinoids, phytocannabinoids, on the surface, on these special structures that are found mainly in the flowers. So the flowering part of the plant, especially in the female flowers, because the cannabis plant has male and female plants. And when these female flowers or flowering chops are not fertilized, they produce even a higher amount of these active ingredients, cannabinoids. Because when the plant is fertilized, it actually stops producing these compounds and all the energy goes into the production of seeds, which is just normal. These cannabinoids and other terpenes and terpenoids are actually secondary metabolites for the plant, which means that it doesn't really need them to survive. It's not like sugars and proteins and other compounds that the plant actually needs to survive. These are just secondary metabolites that the plant uses for specific things, for, let's say, helping it use the number of herbivores that are attacking it, for attracting different other positive, let's say, animals that can attack these other herbivores that are eating the plant, so to speak. So it's a complex mechanism of communication for the plant, and also other specific functions. You know, the typical cannabinoids and the trichomes. If you ever held a bud, as they call it, which is the flowering part of the female plant, it's often very sticky. So it's also a very it's a mechanism to entrap different insects that are trying to, let's say, suck juices from the plant, like aphids or other ways of, you know, attacking this plant and eating it. So it's a physical mechanism. It's also, in a sense, a communication mechanism for other species, which is really intriguing. You know, the plants have mechanisms to attract other species, other animals that can help them in their safety. It's really amazing. And it's a symbiotic, say, relation that has developed over thousands of years, even millions of years. So it's really, really interesting in the sense. But going back to the cannabinoids, so these compounds have a very interesting feature, is that they actually act on our endogenous cannabinoid system. So every one of us has this so-called endocannabinoid system, which is a very important system. Most people have heard of the immune system, but a lot of people have never heard of the endocannabinoid system. So the endocannabinoid system, very generally speaking, is a system that provides balance to the body, or homeostasis, as it's called technically. So this is a very important thing when you know that our body actually tries to keep itself working at optimal levels. So we have different systems, you know, that make sure that our temperature remains optimal, that we have enough water, that when it gets hot, all these systems go into action so you do not lose as much water as you could. When you get cold, other systems go into action, you start trembling, you know, and all these other systems. So the body tries to maintain this optimal state for it to function in the best and most optimal way. And this is something that the endocannabinoid system tries to maintain. It actually is a system, it's a meta system, it's a system that sees that all the other systems work in the correct way. So the immune system, the cardiovascular system, the nervous system, all these systems can be affected by the endocannabinoid system when they do not work as they should be working.
So to put a kind of simplistic approach to this, as you described, the pharmaceutical drugs are maybe targeting a single symptom or one or two symptoms. With cannabis, the phytocannabinoids, i.e. the cannabinoids that are coming from the plant that you're taking externally, it helps to bring the endocannabinoid system back into balance, or your body into balance via the endocannabinoid system. Is that the kind of distinction?
Yes, exactly. That's exactly what I was heading towards to, which is when this endocannabinoid system does not work correctly for various reasons. You know, maybe there's something not working correctly with the enzymes that make or break the endocannabinoids. Maybe there's the receptors are not working correctly, or they're less or more of them. And so many things can happen and which dysregulate the endocannabinoid system. And if we take these exogenous cannabinoids, as you mentioned, plant cannabinoids, we can actually rebalance the system, because these cannabinoids, plant cannabinoids, especially THC and others, actually bind, they activate the same receptors as the endocannabinoids, the endogenous cannabinoids. So this is very important. This is the basis of how plant cannabinoids can help us in providing, restoring, in a sense, balance to our body. And because the endocannabinoid system has this effect on many other systems, by providing balance to the endocannabinoid system, we can also provide balance to other systems. And this is just a simplistic way of looking at the endocannabinoid system and cannabinoids in general, because in nature it's not like we like to simplify things. Things are much more complicated. And we can see also with these plant cannabinoids that they actually do not activate or bind only to these cannabinoid receptors, but they have effects on many other receptors, also ion channels. They have effect on enzymes and other transporter proteins. So they have very, very, let's say, complex effects on many other receptors and systems, and not only the endocannabinoid system.
Right. Okay. That's interesting. So, I mean, that fits quite well with the holistic idea, doesn't it? Because it's such a kind of interconnected and interdependent system that it makes sense that it would have collateral effects, if you like.
Exactly. If something doesn't work somewhere in your body, the effects, the symptoms can be somewhere else. So being very local in a sense and trying to figure out what's wrong locally because of a symptom can sometimes not be the right solution. We have to really know the mechanism from where this started and how we can actually repair it. And this is called also one of the typical things of cannabis is it, that it doesn't affect just one thing, because when you, let's say, inhale cannabinoids or take them orally, they go into your body and they don't go only to one specific area, but they go all over the body and even into your brain. So the effects of these plant cannabinoids can be felt in different areas, and they can, of course, reach the area where this problem actually started, and they can correct it in a way. If, of course, they are the right type of active compounds for this specific problem.
Yeah. And so, I mean, in terms of the active compounds, the cannabinoids, and look, we could, again, go and talk for hours about this, but I've got a very specific question, because I think this is something that isn't very well understood. But so obviously there are 144 identified cannabinoids at the moment. Is that right?
Yes, that's the number that I'm aware of. So which doesn't mean that every cannabis plant has 144 cannabinoids. You know, a lot of these cannabinoids have been identified in very condensed hash or extracts, and they're present in really, really small quantities. The majority of cannabis plants has a few of these compounds, such as THCA, CBDA, and CBGA, which are in higher percentages, and the other ones are very, very low quantities.
Yeah, and obviously, so CBD and THC are the most famous ones. But there's, you know, CBG, CBN, and all the precursors that you mentioned as well. In the UK, and I think in probably a lot of Europe, because of the legal system, I think THC seems to be quite demonized, because everyone's petrified of talking about cannabis in any kind of light where people might enjoy it recreationally, let's say. But actually, my question is around fact that whilst everyone's talking about CBD being this amazing cure-all compound, it's true that THC has a lot of therapeutic abilities too. Is that right?
It is. And this is something that has recently come up. And, you know, the first cannabinoid to be studied, really, a plant cannabinoid to be studied in mass, was delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol, so THC. Nobody cared about CBD at the beginning, because it didn't have, it was not active. In a sense, it didn't have this psychotropic effect. It didn't cause the high. So they thought it wasn't active in a sense. So all the studies went into THC and finding the mechanism, how it worked. And this also was the reason that we actually identified the endocannabinoid system, which was, let's say, over 25 years ago. We actually started learning about how it works with the identification of the receptors and then the endogenous cannabinoids such as anandamide in 1992. And this was the beginning of really understanding how these compounds work in our body. And it was also, you can see, an increase in the number of studies done with cannabis, cannabinoids, and the endocannabinoid system right at that time it started. And now it's just exploding. There are literally studies coming out every single day about cannabis, cannabinoids, the endocannabinoid system. So as I mentioned before, it's really, really very interesting field. And to go back to the question, you wanted to know about THC and the demonization of THC, which is what is happening actually now. There was an article I just saw a few weeks ago that said that THC has more beneficial effects than we thought, because all the attention, as you mentioned, is towards CBD, which of course does have a lot of therapeutic uses. But THC actually is a true cannabinoid in a sense. It's the molecule that actually binds. It's a partial agonist to the CB1, the CB2 receptor, and it really has a lot of therapeutic effect. But the main thing that's always causing a problem is the so-called psychotropic effect, the high that it causes. And this, of course, can also be a therapeutic effect. The euphoria caused by THC, you know, which is enjoyed by a lot of recreational users or social users, in a sense, is something that can be also very helpful for patients, because being more, let's say, happy or smiling is something that a lot of patients can find a lot of relief in. You know, it's not a bad thing having euphoria. It's really actually a good thing, especially for patients who are suffering, for patients who are in pain all the time, for cancer patients. It's really important to have these moments, these breaks when they can relax, when they can actually
smile. Quality of life.
Exactly. And this, you know how much important quality of life is. So it's being really demonized and being shunned in a way. So THC is the bad guy, CBD is the good guy. It's not like that at all. No. Both of them are good guys in a sense. And both of them work best when they are together.
Yes. Yeah.
So you can't have one without the other to have the best therapeutic effects.
Yeah.
You know? And this is,
carry on, please.
And this is one of, as I mentioned before, the difference between pharmaceutical drugs and these so-called botanical drugs. So pharmaceutical drugs, typically you will find that pharmaceutical companies will find a compound from a plant that is active. They will isolate it. They will modify it slightly so they can patent it. And then they will produce it in mass and sell it for a lot of money. That's how it works usually. With cannabis, it doesn't work that way. We have not one compound, but many compounds that together work synergistically to produce these therapeutic effects. If you isolate one of them and you produce it synthetically and you use it, you do not have the same effects, the same efficacy as you have usually with these whole plant extracts or products or, let's say, flowers and so on. Because there's a lot of compounds missing. And even in really, really small quantities, some compounds can have very, very specific and crucial effects in the efficacy of how a preparation, let's say a cannabinoid preparation, works or doesn't work in a specific patient.
Yeah. And I'm just conscious of time, but I mean, I guess in that respect, those jurisdictions where they're allowing up to 1% THC, so the ones that you named, like Switzerland and Uruguay, etc., the quality of the cannabis that they're allowed to sell would probably be more effective than what we're allowed in the UK and Slovenia, for example.
We are talking about hemp's this, okay? This is not
hemp. Yes.
Yeah, this is not medical cannabis. This is hemp. So we have to, there's a distinction between the two. But yes, if let's say you make an extract, you make a preparation, or you vaporize a flower that has been, let's say, grown in Switzerland, which has a limit of 1% THC, but has a higher level of CBD also, 20, 18%. When you limit a cannabinoid like THC, you limit the whole production of all the other constituents. So you will have less other cannabinoids and less other constituents such as terpenes and terpenoids. So I didn't mention it before, but terpenes, these are the aromatic compounds found in cannabis. This is the smell, the taste of cannabis. You know, phytocannabinoids like THC, they have no smell, so you can actually not smell them. But you do smell these terpenes. These flavors are mainly from terpenes. So they're very important constituents because they actually have by themselves and have been studied, have therapeutic effects, but also in conjunction with phytocannabinoids, when they are together with phytocannabinoids such as THC and CBD, they can increase, enhance the therapeutic effects of THC, and they can reduce some of the negative, unwanted effects that sometimes THC can have. Not only that, some of these constituents, such as, let's say, beta-mercin, they actually modulate how you perceive the effects of THC. And this is really, really interesting. Again, as I said, in such low quantities, in 1% or 2%, they can have major differences in how we perceive and how we feel, let's say, the therapeutic effects of other cannabinoids. So really, really important molecules. And if you do not have them, if you have only THC synthesized in the lab, well, the effects are really different. And this is not just scientifically speaking, but this is speaking from the perspective of patients who have tried both types of medications. So synthetic THC versus, let's say, a whole plant extract or flowers. Most of them will say that they will prefer let's say, the natural
remedies.
Yeah, the whole plant. Because also the quantities used usually with whole plant extracts, you need lower levels of these compounds to have the same effect, which of course is good for just about anything from a financial point of view, from a, let's say, potential side effect point of view. For, you know, I often get asked, what is the optimal dose for cannabinoids? It's the minimum dose that you use to have an effect. You don't need more, you know. So this is very important. If you can lower this dose with these whole plant products, then of course this is beneficial for the therapy you're doing. And this is something that usually does not occur when these products are isolated in the
pharmacy. Yeah. Cool. And Gregor, I think we're going to call time on part one here, and I'll welcome you back for next week's show, because I've got lots more questions for you.
Sure.
I'd just like to say thank you for part one.
Thank you for inviting me. It was a pleasure.
No worries. That was a great show. I really hope you enjoyed that. I've been really looking forward to this, because I think it's really important for us to understand how our medical system is set up and how difficult it is for cannabis to fit into that. And as we discussed, there's a real focus on treating the symptoms rather than the underlying issue. So that poses a lot of problems for a plant like cannabis that has so many active compounds within it. Anyway, there's much more to discuss in part two next week, so I hope you join me again for that. As I mentioned last week, I hosted the Greenlight event on Thursday in Shoreditch in London, which was really great, a new experience for me, and I met some really interesting people. And in fact, I ended up chairing three panels on various topics, and I really, really enjoyed that. So if you're organizing an event and you need a chair for your panels, please do reach out. I've had a lot of fun doing that. I've also got a nice trip to Malta coming up in November, where I'll be speaking at the Medical Cannabis Summit. So I've got that to look forward to as well. As usual, if you're enjoying the show, I'd be really grateful for an iTunes review if you can spare the time. And that just leaves me to say, have a great week, and I'll see you back here for part two with Gregor next week. Take care.